It's Billy Bear and Dan Haggerty here. What is going on here today?
It's a technical day from hell, I'll tell you.
This is not good. This is not coming up to our usual standard of broadcast excellence here. This is ridiculous.
We're on the air now, though.
At least we think we are. So,
Billy, what's going on? Getting some strange news out of
everywhere. Yeah, well, this Benghazi thing, Benghazi, Libya, we're still talking about this. The White House seems to be acknowledging now that
that the event was planned. It was not spontaneous. The attack on the consulate, right?
Yeah. Yeah, it wasn't a spontaneous event, like they said. They said it was precipitated by that YouTube video trailer that had been out for several months. Now they're saying that, yeah, it was something that was Al-Qaeda related, in spite of Barack Obama getting bin Laden, and supposedly Al-Qaeda is not a threat anymore. Well, apparently they are.
Oh, yeah, well, that didn't work very well, did it? Yeah.
So that's coming out all over the place. Seems like a real mess. They're holding hearings right now.
Yeah, that means Susan Rice basically lied to Congress and to the public. They've been saying since this event happened that it was a spontaneous event caused by some YouTube video, but that's not true. And the State Department said yesterday in testimony that they knew about it immediately, that it was a planned event. The streets were quiet in Benghazi, and all of a sudden, armed men entered the compound and began the attack. Nothing spontaneous at all about it. So
that's going on. Also, obviously, the presidential debate was last week, and what did it tell us? I don't know what it told us, but it told us that Mitt Romney put Barack Obama in a position where at least Barack Obama could expose himself for who he is, at least to some extent, and I think who he is, and became clear his average intelligence on a good day. Not very well informed, and basically he doesn't seem to know what's going on, doesn't seem to really care what's going on, has a hard time communicating that when he's not being prompted by the teleprompter, and he's basically a punk who's running this country. And Mitt Romney did his job as far as that goes. As far as the content of the debate, we don't have much to comment on that. It's too much to get into who was telling the truth, who was not telling the truth, what was exaggerated, what was obfuscate. It's all something else. But for performance and style, Mitt Romney certainly did a good job. He allowed Obama to have the opportunity to show what he's really all about, or at least partially about.
That's right. It was pretty much a beatdown, a slapdown against Obama, and all the Democrats are screaming now that Jim Lehrer didn't do his job, Romney lied. I mean, whatever excuse you
got. Yeah, I actually thought Jim Lehrer did a great job. I mean, he just basically, to a large extent, stood out of the way. It seemed like that's the way a debate, you know, is closer to the way a debate should be.
Well, the media likes events managed to have the outcome they like. So what Jim Lehrer did was not to their liking. And as Jim Lehrer said, look, these guys were talking to each other.
Well, they agreed on the format, obviously, too.
Well, they were talking to each other. He didn't want to interrupt them. He said, the voters are going to learn more from these exchanges than from me shepherding them into one question.
Yeah, I think that's accurate. And it looked like Obama seemed to be looking at Jim Lehrer, like kind of appealing to him to bail him out. And
help!
Yes,
help!
And Lehrer didn't do it, which I think was good.
Yeah.
So anyway, that's what happened to that debate. Now, the next debate should be especially entertaining, coming up tomorrow night, a vice presidential debate with Biden and Paul Ryan. So a little twist in this. It's ridiculous.
Well, when is the next president's debate?
I think it's next Tuesday, a week from yesterday.
Okay,
yeah.
And that's the one that's going to be out in Long Island.
Right, at Hofstra.
Right.
Nice conservative university. That should be interesting.
Yeah.
But anyway, with the vice presidential debate, what's coming out now is not surprising. Martha Raddatz is the
moderator,
and as it turns out, she and Obama seem to know each other. Actually, Barry Obama, as he was referred to by somebody who actually was a witness to this, was at her wedding in 1991. So they know each other over 20 years. Not only that, her at this point former husband, who was the groom at this wedding, was a classmate of Obama's at Harvard Law School and on law review with him.
You got to be kidding. So, all right, well, that just shows you how incestuous the cultural elite and the mainstream media and the establishment elite are in this country.
And she's going to be the objective moderator for this debate.
Oh, yeah, sure. I guess she's put in purposely to help.
But, I mean, who knows? Maybe Obama's had nothing to do with her or her former husband in 20 years. I mean, that's possible, right?
I don't think so.
Possible, but it's not the way it is.
No, I understand her husband has a position within the administration.
Yeah, he does, but it's not an important position. He's only the head of the FCC.
Oh, okay.
Well, that's not like it's got anything to do with information or anything like that.
There you go. Political incest, let's call it.
Yeah, and she'll be moderating. So, out of all the people in the world, she's the one moderating. So that's kind of interesting.
So the fix is in.
At least the information got out. Better that it got out now than if nobody knew about it.
Yeah, that's true. So what else have we got?
What else? So this is interesting. Our friend Jerry Corsi had an article in World Net Daily that came out last night regarding that wedding ring that Obama's been wearing for over 30 years now on his left hand index finger. And they've done some analysis of that wedding ring, and supposedly it's the same ring that he used when he married Michelle Obama, that is. That was Beast I was in the middle of saying, if anybody misconstrued that. Anyway, it's the same ring that he used to get married to Michelle. He was wearing it in 1981. There's pictures of him wearing it throughout the years. There was speculation when he was in law school about what that ring represented. There were some jokes made about it that it's supposedly in writing from some articles in some papers in school, in law school. Anyway, the ring, on blowing the ring up, a picture of the ring, shows that there's some Arabic writing on the ring. And the writing that's on that ring...
Wait a minute, like the
ring? Like an inscription.
Okay.
All around the outside of the ring. And there's pictures on the internet blown up of you could see it. If you read Arabic, ostensibly you'd know what it said.
You mean the inscription is in Arabic?
It's in Arabic. And the inscription on this ring that Obama wears supposedly to this day as a wedding band, and he was wearing over 30 years back when he posed with his Pakistani roommate, says, there is no God but Allah.
Are you kidding? Do you know what that means? When you say... This is how you become converted to Islam. If you say with sincerity, there is no God but Allah, and
well, be careful, make sure you're not sincere when you're quoting them.
And Muhammad is his prophet. If you say that with sincerity, you're automatically a Muslim. So we can take it that Obama is a Muslim. He's wearing the inscription on his finger on a piece of gold. How much more proof do you need?
Well, I know. I mean, I wouldn't feel comfortable wearing that.
Well, I'll tell you, they've got a lot of problems. They've got this Big Bird problem.
What's with this Big Bird thing? I mean, we know that Romney made a reference to Big Bird with the whole PBS thing, but what's going on with that?
Well, it's funny. Romney says he wants to take out the funding for NPR. You know, NPR...
And PBS, right.
And PBS. PBS especially. Forgetting the fact that NPR got the bulk of... Ray Kroc's fortune from McDonald's, people don't realize it. Oh, yeah, this is a few years ago.
Oh, really?
Several billion. And after the first few days of promoting that gift, they hushed it up because they didn't want people to know that NPR is a very wealthy organization. So Romney rightfully wants to remove funding from them and remove it from PBS also. But as a quip during the debate, he said, you know, I like Big Bird, okay? But, you know, apparently Big Bird doesn't like the Obamas. I'm not...
What are you going to do? You got something planned here?
Yeah, this clip came over
the... You sure you want to do this? We've been experiencing some major tech problems today.
What the hell at this point? You know,
I'll give it a shot.
Okay, here's an actual interview an audio of Mrs. Obama and Big Bird on the PBS show.
Here we go.
Yeah.
Well, look who's here to push your husband's socialist health care agenda. Well, maybe you're here to finally show us your husband's United States birth certificate.
No, Bird, I'm not.
That's because you can't. Are you absolutely sure he wasn't born in Kenya?
I'm sure, Big Bird.
That's not what the basket bunch said.
Yeah, your husband's a stinking liar.
We're going to run him out of office.
Yeah, that's, I'll find it.
That's, I hope people have heard that.
Oh, I'm sure
well,
they did.
In here, where can they find this?
Well, that's a good question. Where can you find it? I'll tell you what. If you just get on YouTube or Google and plug in Big Bird Asked Michelle Obama, just Big Bird and Michelle, and you'll find it. It's
probably missing by this point.
No, it's
probably
pretty,
purged.
Yeah, right, exactly. Because PBS came out and told the Obama campaign, do not use Big Bird anymore. So
misuse Big Bird.
Exactly.
They're misusing Big Bird. Anyway, believe it or not, things are pretty serious. So the economy, though, is getting better here. 7.8% unemployment, I believe that.
Yes, I
think I predicted that.
Yeah.
You know, Rick Santelli did.
Yep. If you believe that, you're in the market for a bridge in Brooklyn.
So, yeah, that was original there.
Yeah, exactly. But what else can you say? I mean, how stupid do you have to be to accept the administration's economic figures at face value? I mean, come on. The unemployment rate has to be in double digits, and it may be approaching 15, 16, 17%.
And how you define it. And
I define it as people that don't have a job. How about that? Not whether you're looking, or whether you want to look, or whether you looked last week, whether you have a job. And one out of four people, I think, or one out of five, is out of a job in this country. So that's the truth.
Well, anyway, so the unemployment number went down. Supposedly, that was a big deal. And the stock market seems to be humming right along. It's down a little as of an hour or so ago, but who knows? Who knows how that's going to go? So everything looking good.
Yeah, well, I think our guest knows how that's going to go. So let's bring him on.
Well, another thing, Dan. We can get into this later. This is actually just breaking. But our guest is the founder of market-ticker.org and is the author of Leverage, How Cheap Money Will Destroy the World, Karl Denninger. How you doing, Karl? You there?
I am doing great. How are you?
I'm all right, I guess.
Good. How you doing, Karl?
So Karl, what's going on with the economy?
I think we should start with this so-called employment report.
Okay.
Since you just brought it up. Let's begin with what the Labor Department, or as I call them, the Bureau of Lies and Scams, that's the BLS, likes to say about supposedly unemployed people. If you give up looking for work, you are no longer unemployed. So if you're trying to find a job, and you can't 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 find a job, and you finally say, you know what, screw this, I'm just going to sit in front of the TV and get drunk, you are no longer unemployed.
Really?
Now, that's a rather interesting little piece of information.
Is the getting drunk part, is that optional, or is that mandatory?
Under Obama's administration, it's probably mandatory, because otherwise, you know, you'd have a stroke if you were actually paying attention to what was going on with what he's done with the economy and what the Republicans have done in the House of Representatives. I mean, between those two, you'd have every reason to stroke out. So you've got to get drunk so that you're not cogent enough to actually understand. I'm only half kidding.
To the reality, the pain of it all.
Okay, so what else about this employment report?
Well, there's much more to this. Yeah, there's much more to this than meets the eye, because the only thing that matters to the common person is one number that's buried in the report. They never talk about this in the headline. Occasionally, you'll see CNBC mention it. It is the chart that I put up every month when I do my analysis on this, and that is the employment participation ratio, which is the percentage of working-age Americans, which is defined as those people 16 to 65, who actually have jobs. And this is, of course, the only number that really matters, because the working-age population goes up every month. So in order to just keep up with the entrance into the workforce, people graduating from high school, and we still are in this phase where that percentage of people is growing. It will start to decline as the boomers age off, but as of right now, it's still going up. In order to keep even with that, you need to put somewhere between 150,000 and 200,000 jobs into the economy every month. So
wow, just wow.
Yeah. So what this means is right. What this means is that a number under 150 is still contraction.
Mm-hmm.
A number in order to actually bring the unemployment rate down for real from actual hiring, in the space of a couple of years to get it, say, down to the 6% range, you would have to be putting a plus 400,000 print up pretty much on an every month basis. And, of course, we haven't been
doing that.
When
was the last time we had a number like that?
Oh,
we saw a number.
Well,
like
it certainly hasn't happened since this last recession yet, okay?
Uh-huh.
So the problem we have with the employment situation is that while Obama likes to claim that there has been 4 million jobs created since the bottom, since the official end of the recession in 2009, the truth is that while there have been about 4 million more people working, there are something like 5 million more people who are in the workforce. So we've actually lost jobs on a participation rate basis. And in fact, although there was a small uptick in that participation rate this last month, it has essentially been flat on its back for the last 3 years. This is a very important piece of information, because what you keep hearing from the Fed and from the government and from everybody else is that quantitative easing and all of the other, the stimulus program, the $800 billion stimulus, all these other actions that the government has taken, they have supposedly helped the employment market to recover. The fact of the matter is that they have done no such thing at all.
Now, do you think that all this QE has had the opposite effect, or do you think it just hasn't helped significantly enough?
It has absolutely had the opposite effect, and the reason is that when you spend in deficit, and the federal government has spent deficits is somewhere between 8 and 12% of the economy for the last 4 years, when you do that, it is exactly identical from an economics perspective, mathematically, from imposing a tax on every transaction in the economy in the amount of the deficit that you spend in. So if you are spending 10% of GDP in deficits by the federal government, which would be about $1.5 trillion a year because we have about a $15 trillion economy, then you are imposing a 10% off-the-top tax upon every transaction, every wage, every product that is sold, everything that is manufactured. And the reason you're doing it is because what the government is doing is emitting into the economy more credit. And by doing that, they debase the value of every single dollar of credit or currency that is currently in the economy. So where you used to have to spend a dollar to buy something, you now have to spend $1.10. Now, it doesn't show up evenly in the economy. In other words, that 10-cent increase doesn't show up everywhere at once. Okay, just like when the tax man comes and takes your money, some of it gets spent by Washington and defense. Some of it goes to food stamps. Some of it goes to Medicare. It doesn't all go in the same place. Same thing happens here. You cannot necessarily control, and in fact, this is one of the lessons of the last two bubbles, the stock bubble and then the housing bubble, is that while you can create these kinds of conditions where debasement happens and these money flows occur, you can't necessarily control where they go. So, in the 1990s, we had the internet bubble where internet stocks were going crazy. In the 2000s, we had the housing bubble where houses were going crazy. Now we have the government hands out money bubble where anything that the government touches goes crazy. But in terms of the actual impact on the common man, what's really happening is that their purchasing power is going down. And when you put this kind of tax into the system, it destroys employment incentives for two reasons. Number one, you're taxing all producers before the goods ever get out the door, which is a terribly inefficient thing to do. Remember, most companies only pay taxes on profits. Okay, so if you have a loss, you don't pay taxes on a loss. You only pay taxes on profits. But this is essentially a gross receipts tax. So it is a tax even on...
If you have a loss, then that's set off against any profits in the future, too, right?
So, correct. But in this particular case, this kind of tax that is created by deficit spending is on production. So it is not on profits. It's on everybody evenly. And it particularly hoses entrepreneurial startups, which is, of course, what creates so many jobs, is people trying to do new and innovative things, because they are typically not profitable in the first few years of their operation. It is terribly destructive to people in the lower and middle classes, because those people need to spend a higher percentage of their money on necessities, food, fuel, shelter, and health care. So those things tend to go up in price first. We've seen gasoline that has doubled in cost in the last 4 years. This is a big part of why. It is not because there's all this Arab unrest or whatever have you. It's simply monetary debasement. And so there is no positive outcome that can come from this. What people need to understand, and it's very difficult to get this through people's heads, and it is exactly the opposite of what you're told. We are all told every day that we must not cut out the deficit spending now because it will hurt the so-called recovery. But once we get the economy back on our feet, on its feet, then we will deal with the deficits and the debt. That's backwards. You cannot have an economic recovery when you are imposing an across-the-board 10% a year tax on every single thing that is going on in the economy. And that's what's happening.
So, Carl, do the people who are making these decisions, who you can identify in a minute, are they? Is it just that they're inept, or what is it?
Some of them, it's difficult to know how many of those people actually understand the mechanics of this. I get into debates with people about this kind of thing all the time, and when you start talking about this, their eyes tend to glaze over. They say, well, Paul Krugman says, or Ben Bernanke says. And I say, why is this so difficult? Get out a piece of paper and a pencil and work this out as a balance sheet. Because everything in life, when it comes to economics, is a balance sheet. Everything balances. Your checkbook balances, your ledger balances at your company. Everything is a balance sheet. Just get it out. Figure it out for yourself. Sit down. Figure out the mechanics of what's going on. The government adds 10% of the economy's worth of additional credit into the economy, where you had to pay for a one unit's worth of production, whether it's gallons of gasoline, loaves of bread, LCD televisions, computers, iPhones, whatever. You now need 1.1 or 110% of what you needed before in units of credit to buy the same thing. That's a tax.
So, Carl, and one of the things I guess you're saying is this is a tax that we didn't get to vote on.
Well, yeah, we didn't get to vote. Yes and no, okay? It's true that the Federal Reserve in their quantitative easing program is not something we got to vote on. They, of course, in their smoky little room voted on that, right, the FOMC members. But remember that we're the ones that ultimately control this because it is the House of Representatives. And this is an important point that everybody needs to take away from this. All spending bills must originate in the House. That's U.S. Constitution. I constantly hear from people on the right, well, that do-nothing Senate that is controlled by the Democrats won't pass a budget, and it's their fault. And that evil SOB sitting in the Oval Office, that, he's a Democrat, and by God, that Obama, he is responsible for all of this because he just wants to spend us into the ground and he wants to tax all the rich people. And what I say to them is this: the House of Representatives is majority Republican-controlled. All spending bills must originate there. So you can complain to me about the Democrats being the ones that are causing this. As soon as the House of Representatives refuses to pass a continuing resolution, says put a balanced budget on our desk, a proposal from the president, which is all he gets to do is make a proposal, something that is actually in balance, not 20 years down the road, 30 years down the road, 40 years down the road, now, today, right now, balanced budget, zero deficits, that goes through the House of Representatives, which, by the way, Paul Ryan's budget has not done that. The budget that the House has passed the last several years has not been balanced, not even close. That goes to the Senate, and when that doesn't pass, when the Senate refuses to take it up, which is what they've done of late, that's fine. Then the House says no continuing resolutions. They turn the lights off, and they go home. The government shuts down. When that happens...
That's basically the same conversation I've had with congressmen here in New Jersey. And they try to be cute and say, when I said, well, listen, you guys control the House. Now, this is obviously since 2010. The Republicans control the House. You have a 60-whatever seat majority that we've given you to do the right thing. Use it. Stop, cut off funding for things. Don't vote any funds. They're like, well, we can't do anything without the Senate's cooperation. We can't pass any legislation. I said, that's fine. I don't want you to pass any legislation. Just stop them from doing what they're doing. And they refuse to do it.
Let's get into that after the break here. It's 9:30 the hour. This is WNJC 1360 AM broadcasting into the Philadelphia area and on the Internet on www.wnjc1360am. And it's halfway through the Bear Haggerty Offensive on Patriot Radio.
Prices are going down. Oh, wait. Okay, programming has been away long enough. Now, back to more on Philadelphia's Renaissance Radio Station, 1360 AM WNJC.
Hey, nice commercial there. So, anyway, So yeah, so Carl, I've had that same discussion, and they blame it on the Senate, you know. But it's absurd.
Well, of course they do, Jeff Miller just did the same thing at a congressional debate that we had out here in Pensacola last night. He's, the Senate, we have to take back the Senate. We have to, I'm standing back there, I'm taping the thing. I'm not one of the participants. I'm just there to run media for it. And my immediate reaction was, you lying sack of, all right? All you had to do was say, there is going to be no legislation that comes through this chamber until we have a balanced budget on the table and it is passed, period. End of discussion. That's it. All Boehner has to do is say, you know what? We waste a lot of money leaving the lights and the air conditioning on in this joint, and we're going to stop doing it until you guys over there on the other side of the Capitol building do your job. Click.
Sounds like government shutdown. And
what's wrong with that?
Gingrich. Well, nothing, but remember what they did to Gingrich when...
Well, I understand that, but you know what? It's time for the... We need statesmen in this country. We need people that are actual representatives. When they tell us that they're going to go to Washington, they're going to budget, they're going to get us a balanced budget, and it's going to happen. And this is the thing that people need to take away from this entire balanced budget thing. Paul Ryan's proposal doesn't actually come into putative balance for 40 years. And the way he gets there is through pie-in-the-sky, never-to-be-achieved economic outcomes. It is important for everybody to understand that it is illegal under the United States Constitution to bind a future Congress. So whatever is passed in this legislative session has absolutely zero impact on the next Congress that comes in. You cannot prevent them from passing some other bill that overrides what you did. So the only promise that matters, the only action that matters, is the one that takes place right now.
Well, yeah, just in general, these numbers are always spoken about as if they're talking about this year when their projections for 10 years or 20 years, our budget saves or our plan or whatever saves $5 trillion. They always leave the second part out, that it's an estimate based on ridiculous assumptions usually, and it could be over many, many years.
Well, not only that, the standard scam is all budget claims when made by a politician are over 10-year time frames. Okay, that's the first part of the scam. The second part of the scam is that all budget claims are made over what are called baseline budgets, which include automatic escalations in spending for every year after the first one.
Wow.
So what you have is, when they say they're cutting spending, they are not actually cutting spending. They are taking something off of the automatic escalation that was otherwise going to take place.
Yeah, Carl, if you remember, we had a similar discussion about a year ago, I think it was, about the whole weight gain and weight loss. Like, if you expect to gain 50 pounds this year and you only gain 40, you talk about like you lost 10 pounds.
Right. Well, that's essentially the same thing. And but this is what's going on, and neither side of the aisle is being honest about this. The problem with what they are doing, besides the fact that they're lying through their teeth, which is bad enough, is that because of the way exponential functions work, anytime you have compound growth, when you hear somebody on CNBC or some other financial media pundit or whatever have you talk about 3% growth in the economy or 2% inflation, anytime they start talking about that, they're talking about an exponential series. That's a geometric function. Any two geometric functions where one has a larger growth rate than the other will always run away from each other. It's mathematically certain.
Now that you mention it, talk about the Federal Reserve a little bit and this whole thing about what their charter says in terms of keeping prices stable and how inflation, we talk about it being 2% or 3%. It doesn't sound like a big deal. Just play that out a little bit for our listeners to have them understand that if inflation is not necessarily part of an economy or doesn't necessarily have to be part of an economy, but it's part of a larger... really a larger scam is from what I can tell you.
Let's start with the basis of what the Federal Reserve Act actually says. It says that the Federal Reserve shall, which is a term of art in legislation, it means you will do it, manage monetary and credit aggregates so as to promote stable prices, maximum employment, and moderate long-term interest rates. And there's a period after the end of that. I may have one or two of the words slightly wrong, but that's what the statute says. Stable is a word defined in the dictionary. It means unchanging. Ben Bernanke just recently got up in front of the public and gave a speech in which he said, our mandate says that we must have low and stable inflation. No, it doesn't. It says you shall have unchanging prices, which is zero inflation. The natural state of all economies is, in fact, a mild deflation because we have productivity improvements. We learn how to do more with less. You've seen this throughout history. We started with human power digging the ground up and trying, you know, picking apples off trees and trying to find little animals that we could grab with our bare hands. And we have now come to the point that we farm mechanically using mechanical advantage from diesel fuel and all of these other things. We have electricity in our homes. We have computers. I can send messages across the country in thousandth of a second where it used to take weeks with a guy on the back of a horse. All of these things are dramatic technological improvements. They mean that in my daily life, I need to do less labor in order to maintain the same standard of living that I used to have. That is deflation. I am able to buy more things with less work. Okay, why shouldn't I, the person who creates this deflation, or you, one of the people who creates this deflation through our innovation and our efforts, why should we not keep the benefit of this in all of it, not some of it, but all of it, in the form of a higher standard of living and more money for the amount of effort that we put in? The answer is you should, but the government says, oh, no, 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 we're going to have stable prices, which is stealing that productivity increase that would otherwise go to you. And then the Federal Reserve puts a topper on it and says, oh, no, stable prices means 2% inflation a year. And you say, well, how can 2% possibly hurt you? Well, the Federal Reserve has sequentially violated this mandate for 100 years, well, actually 99 and change now, because 1913 was when the Federal Reserve Act was passed. If you had something that cost $100 in 1913, and you took a 2% inflation rate and you put that on that for 100 years, you would have to spend $724.46 for that same item. To put this a slightly different way, 96 cents of the dollar that you earned has been turned to dust in those 100 years. Now, that's assuming that they actually met a 2% inflation rate. In point of fact, they've been off by about 50%. Bernanke likes to claim 2%, but the truth is it's been about 3% on an average basis. So that $100
item... over almost a century, you're saying,
an
average...
Correct, on an annualized basis. Some years higher, some lower, but the average has been about 3%. So on, if you took that same $100 item, remember, we were $700 and change, right? At 3%,
right.
that same $100 item in 100 years costs $1,921.86. And about a nickel of the original dollar that you had still remains as yours.
So, well, Carl, wouldn't people just, I mean, basically, I've had this conversation as recently as last week with somebody when they're saying, oh, yeah, of course there's inflation, but everything goes up, so it basically all cancels out. It doesn't really matter. It's just a number. What's the difference of, you know, my house in 1960 cost $20,000, but I was also only making $5,000 a year or something.
Oh, well, that's the spin they put on it. They try to tell you that it's a natural occurrence.
Yeah, so...
Well, of course, that's the
spin. It's not as benign as just, like, the number and everything goes up, so it doesn't matter.
Well, of course, that's the spin they put on it, but let's look at the facts, okay? The facts are that over the last 4 years, median incomes, not in inflation-adjusted terms, but in actual gross dollar terms, have gone down by between 4 and 5%, depending on which number you're looking at. Now, that's the average household income. Obviously, some people have done very well, some people have done even worse, but the average is down 4% in nominal terms. Now, add the inflation rate to that, and it's down quite a bit more than 4%. At the same time that incomes are down 4%, gas prices have doubled. So, not only have I lost earnings power as an average American in the amount of money that comes into my household, but I have to pay twice as much to fill up my car to go to work. Those people who want to argue that this does not have any real impact because prices and wages go up at the same time need to have their head examined. There is no such thing as a lossless transaction anywhere. I don't care if it's in energy resources. I don't care if it's in the economy. It doesn't matter. There's no such thing as a lossless event. And the reason is because people are not perfect. We all make mistakes. We all do things that are wasteful. We all dissipate some percentage of our wealth towards useless ends or even ends that are destructive. Everybody does. Businesses make errors. They make bad investments. They end up buying equipment that doesn't do what they thought it was going to do, and they have to throw it out. They buy inventory. It goes in the trash. Your local restaurant probably fills half a dumpster full of waste food every day from things that don't get eaten. All of these things are economic waste. And so there's slippage in the economy. And the transmission of policy and the transmission of inflation from one end to the other leaves the people on the barbell ends behind. And what that means is prices go up faster than wages. And when you get into a situation...
Okay, so inflation is basically bad for the average person, no matter how you cut it. But now, how does it affect the banks who are, you know, obviously in a different position than the people? Are they benefiting fundamentally from inflation, or does it not really matter with them either?
It would matter to them if they were actually loaning out their own capital. And this is one of the problems that we have with the banking system, in that the common thing that we're all told when we're in school, and by the way, all the teachers that have put this in front of students say, oh, I'll go to prison for this. Because this is, if people understood how this actually works, there'd probably be a revolution by morning. I think there was a famous man that said that once. I don't remember. That's not my quote,
Henry
by the way.
Ford.
Yeah, Henry Ford said that. Don't attribute it to me. But here is the reality. What you're taught is that people go into the bank, they deposit their money because they want to be safe. They don't want to get robbed at night. Okay, all right, fine. So now your money is sitting in the bank, and the banker takes your $100, and he loans out $90 of it, and the 10 he keeps as a reserve, and then that person spends the money and comes back in, and it goes around until it's extinguished with a 10% reserve each time. This is what you're taught in school. This is a lie. It's very important that everybody understands that this is a lie. What actually happens is that you walk into the bank, and you say, I want to borrow $20,000 to buy a car, and the bank strokes your cashier's check for $20,000. They never had a single penny of any of that from anywhere. You go take the $20,000, now remember, they just created this out of thin air, right? This money didn't exist. You take that check down to the car dealer, and you spend it. And after you do that, the car dealer brings a $20,000 check back into the bank because he doesn't want to be sitting on an endorsed check that could get stolen. He deposits it, and the bank takes 10% of that as the reserve, and then they're off to the races and does it, and they do it again. Notice the difference. The bank never actually put any of its own capital on the line to do this. All right, now, it gets worse than that. There's supposed to be a reserve ratio that's set in the law. TARP, in the middle of the bill, was this little one-sentence addition that said that this particular other bill that had been passed years before is made effective now instead of 3 years, 4 years hence when it was supposed to originally go into effect. And when I read TARP, which of course started out as two pages from Henry Paulson and ended up as this great big thing, I looked at that and said, what the devil is that referring to? So I went and I looked it up. That bill, when TARP was passed, made it possible for the Federal Reserve to drop the reserve ratio, the amount of actual capital that a bank must hold against loans, to zero. Made it legal for Ben Bernanke to do that unilaterally. So banks in the United States, as of today, do not have to hold any, zero capital, according to the law, provided that Bernanke wants to allow it, against loans they make. That's now legal.
Well, that's unbelievable. I mean, I thought the 10%, which was the old rule, I guess, I mean, that's outrageous enough. It should be 100%.
Well, it technically, when you want to get down to it from a pure monetary perspective, from a purely economics perspective, what is going on with all of this unbacked emission of credit is exactly identical in the economy, counterfeiting. It's the same thing as if I took $100 bills and ran them off of my Xerox machine in my office. It works exactly the same way, because what I'm doing is representing in the economy more money than actually exists.
Except if you did it, you'd go to jail. The Federal Reserve does it, and...
the Federal Reserve is not the worst offender. Okay, at least when the Federal Reserve buys treasuries through quantitative easing, it's Congress that decided to spend the money, and under the Constitution, Congress has the money power. So if you want to get down to the legalities and the technicalities of it, Congress is within its power to do this. We're within our power, of course, to fire them. The problem is that the reason we got into this mess is not so much because Congress was diluting the money supply, although they were. During Bush's time in office, it was about $600 billion a year. It's about a 5% deficit. But not just that, that Congress was doing this, but that the banks were doing this. We went, over the course of about 7 years, we doubled the amount of debt in the system. We put $25 trillion worth of credit, which spends exactly the same as cash, into the system over the space of 7 years. There was one quarter in 2007 where we had about $190 billion worth of GDP that got added. That's actual production. And during that same three-month period, we put over $1.5 trillion worth of debt into the system. We put something on the order of
seven times,
into the system in debt as we did in production.
So, Carl, without getting too far into these details, so what's going on here? What can people do? What can we expect? What do you see as the timeline for what's happening? Is there any way to fix this? It sounds overwhelming. It sounds like it's a big scam.
It is overwhelming. It is overwhelming. Let's start with the basics. In 2000, we needed to accept approximately a 7 to 10% contraction in the economy and about a 10% contraction in the size of the federal government. In 2007, 7 years later, those numbers were approximately double. We would have had to accept a roughly 15% contraction in the economy, which, by the way, is a formal definition of a depression, is a 10% contraction, and a approximately 20% contraction in the size of government. Today, to balance the budget, to do it right now, we would have to accept a almost 40% contraction in the size of the government and a contraction in the size of domestic output, at least in the short term, of about a third. Now, this is 4 years later. What needs to be understood by everybody is that in another 4 years, those ratios will probably approximately double again. We won't get there. In 5 to 10 years from now, approximately 10 years is the outside edge of the window that I've calculated, the escalation in federal medical spending alone, which has gone from $53 billion in 1980 to $850 billion last year, will approximately equal $1.8 to $2 trillion, which is more than can possibly be spent. Remember, the federal budget, the whole thing is only $4 trillion. So the amount of spending on medical care, even with Obamacare in the system, is going to approximately double in 8 years. We will not be able to.
It's approximately $4 trillion, 40+% of which is borrowed anyway, right?
Right. The problem is that all of the tax money that we're taking in today, in about 10 years, approximately all the tax money we're taking in today will simply go to pay the medical spending. None will pay for Social Security, defense, or anything else.
You said that these numbers are going to double from what they are now in the next 4 years, and then you add, and I don't know if people caught that quote, we're not going to get there. What do you mean by that?
What I mean is that the market will throw up before it allows us to get to the point where we borrow every single dollar other than what is spent on senior citizens and indigent medical care. And
so
when that happens...
So with the market reaction, you mean people are going to just stop buying treasuries, or what's the market reaction?
When the market reacts, what you're going to see is a stock market collapse, a bond market that goes crazy. If the Fed attempts to intervene, the people will starve en masse because the cost of food and fuel will go to the moon. And so everybody that is in the middle class and below will find themselves on the street and hungry. That's the recipe for a revolution. We won't get that far for that reason, okay? So what happens typically is what happened in Greece. Greece had another 4, maybe 5 years before they mathematically hit this wall that was going to cause the same disruption that we can see 10 years out. When they got to the point that they were three, four years from there, the market said, no more of this. They refused to buy any more of their debt, and all of a sudden you had a funding crisis, and the Greek government finds themselves with the situation you have now. They try to impose austerity. The people say, but we're not going to put up with that. And the answer is, it doesn't matter what you're going to put up with. There's no money. Okay? When the checks bounce, it doesn't make any difference what the political claims are or what people think they're entitled to. You don't have the money. You can't spend it. That's the end of the discussion. And so then you end up with the clash between, well, but you promised me, and I don't have anything in my wallet. The result is riots, civil unrest, and the possible failure of the government itself. We have to balance the budget right now, today. It's not going to happen. Neither of the presidential candidates are serious about it. Nobody in Congress is serious about it. But I can tell you from conversations I've had with people on the Hill, especially on the Senate side, they understand the math. They understand the numbers, They just know that they're going to get fired if they actually press for this. And none of them in small numbers will stand up and do that because, A, it is still isn't going to happen. They're just going to lose a job. So what you need is you need a majority of the Congress to come to their senses and say, our job is less important than keeping this country from disintegrating. And so far that recognition hasn't happened. And every day
I don't hold much hope of that happening.
I don't either, which means...
The scenario you're describing reminds me of, if you read the book When Money Dies, which is about the collapse of the Weimar Republic and the hyperinflation that went on there and the subsequent riots, revolutions, Hitler coming to power. Why do you say that wouldn't happen here?
Because in the Weimar Republic, what occurred was the German government at the time took the money power, rendered it non-debt-backed, and started issuing raw currency into the system in an attempt to close the budget gap. It is illegal for that to happen in the United States. The Congress would have to pass a law taking back from the Federal Reserve the money power, vesting it in themselves, and then start sending out checks unbacked by anything. If that happens, then you get the Zimbabwe, or for that matter, the Weimar Republic outcome. That's exactly how Zimbabwe blew up, by the way. Same thing. So, but as long as you have to debt back your currency, it can't happen, because in order for it to occur, in order for you to expand the money and credit supply, somebody has to willingly take on the debt on the other side. And what people need to understand about this is the magnitude involved. There's $54 trillion in debt outstanding in the system right now. In order for us to undergo a doubling in the inflationary pressure, in other words, a halving of the value of the dollar, you would have to find somebody to take up $54 trillion, which is 10 times the amount of debt that the federal government has taken on over the last 4 years. That's a huge number, and is virtually impossible to find someone who would be willing to do that. If you can't find someone willing and able to take on the debt, then this scenario can't happen, unless they change the law.
Given the inevitability of the way the arithmetic works out here, what is the absolute best-case scenario? If you were running the show, did exactly what you think needs to be done, what's the best-case scenario?
The best-case scenario is you force the banks to take the leverage out of the system. You make them go to a $1 of capital scenario so they can only lend out what they actually have in capital. Interest rates would go up dramatically. The government would have to shed most or all of the programs that are unconstitutional, which is 90% of what they do. In order to prevent Granny and those people who are of low incomes from immediately being bankrupted by medical expenses, you have to break all of the monopoly powers that are currently in the medical system. This would drop the cost of medical care by about 80%. Now, people find that hard to believe, but it's true. Go take a look at the Oklahoma Surgical Center's price list and then compare that against your local hospital for the same procedure.
That's interesting. We had a guest. We covered that about three weeks ago.
Right.
Yeah. And that's, and this was, but see, here's the thing. You could pay for your medical care out of your pocket if it was a fifth of what it costs today, okay? So we would have to do that. We have to fix our energy dependence problem, which requires a Manhattan Project-style crash program to get us off the Arab oil teat, because at the same time, we have to stop the defense spending. We have to cut that back to about half of where it is today. We do those things, we can pull away from the cliff. Now, unemployment, if we were to do that, we would see a 20 to 30% contraction in GDP in the short term. We would see unemployment probably in the mid to upper teens for a period of time, but not for very long. The job loss in the medical sector, for example, would be tremendous. However, once that was redirected back into productive things and the actual production of goods and services, the dollar would become tremendously strong. We'd be an exporting powerhouse. And at the same time, we'd get our stature back as a manufacturing destination, because it would not be economical for people to be importing trash into the United States anymore. We'd have our manufacturing back. We also have to stop the currency manipulation games that are coming both out of Saudi Arabia and the rest of the Middle East, as well as China, because that's part of what's fueling what we're doing right now. But all of these things are interconnected.
I don't see any of that scenario happening.
I don't either, which is why I tell people, be prepared, because history tells us that when governments continue to lie in this kind of a format for the length of time that they have, And in our case, it's been the distortions we've got in the system right now are 30 years old. Okay, they're not going to come out in an afternoon. When you have governments that do this, typically, the three words you never hear in D.C. are, I screwed up. And because of that, there is no will, no ability within the people in the Beltway to fix this problem and to address it. There are a number of people that understand it. Jim DeMint's one of them. There's a handful of others. They've, you know, if you hear him talking when you get one of these guys that are being candid, they'll tell you. You know, they say enough that you understand that they get it. The problem is that they can't get a coalition together that's large enough to do anything about it. So what's going to end up happening is we're going to go right up to the edge where the market throws up its hands and says, we've had enough of this, pay me. And as soon as that occurs, you're going to see the stock market come apart. You're going to see corporate profits come apart. The bond market, particularly on the corporate side, will come apart. The banking system will undergo a cataclysmic mess, as will the insurance industry, because that's where all those long-dated bonds are, is in the insurance business and the banks, along with pension funds. That's how they match duration across what they have to pay out. The destruction in those parts of the financial industry and in the rest of society is going to be enormous. But I don't see how it's avoided because we don't have the political will to do anything about it right now. So
yeah, I think the three of us certainly agree that the idea of the politicians doing this and the people being responsible enough to go along with this, especially, I mean, everybody knows that more and more people are realizing how much we've been lied to and how much we've been stolen from at this point. It's kind of hard to go along with anything these guys say, but they won't say it anyway. So when you say prepare, like, what do you do?
What I tell people in general is you want duration out of all duration risk out of everything you do. If you don't have liquidity, then you don't have anything. Anything that you're locked up in is bad news, because when this comes apart, the speed with which it happens is going to surprise. 2008 was bad. This is going to be worse. But I don't know whether it's going to be tomorrow.
What's liquid? I mean, I don't. As far as trusting these institutions, I mean, I'm
concerned. Well, cash is king in a deflationary cycle like this. Mm-hmm. And anything that carries a risk of conversion is bad news. So, you know, but is there the best thing in the world to have is things that can't be taxed and can't be stolen, which means intellectual capital, your personal ability to do things, is the best place to be positioned. Now, of course, you can't put everything there. Accumulated wealth can't all sit in your head. It has to be in something tangible in some form. But you can't be looking at anything that is based upon the execution and maintenance of leverage as a long-term investment. That doesn't mean that you can't be trading these things. You most certainly can. I do it every day. But
would you be comfortable with somebody in physical cash if you knew, let's say, physically it was totally safe? Is that something? I mean, because that's obviously what you don't want to be in if there's inflation.
There's an Argentine-style deflation over our revaluation of the currency overnight. You just lost maybe half your
dollar. Well, Carl's talking about the opposite. He's talking about...
If there's an Argentine-style... Argentina, remember, owed money in external funds in an externally denominated amount. If you see the government do something like send everybody an unbacked $500,000 check in the mail, okay, something insane along those orders, if people really start honestly talking about doing such a thing, then you get whatever you have in the way of wealth into tangible physical things that can't be taken from you, i.e. a place to live, a bunch of chickens and goats, and a means of producing enough power to survive, because the world is about to come to an almost complete economic end, and you're going to see a Weimar Germany / Zimbabwe kind of outcome.
Okay, Carl. Well, we'll pick this up. We're just about out of time. We'll pick this up some other time.
On that pleasant note, we'll say goodbye, Carl.
Hey, Carl.
All right, thank you.
Great having you on. We'll talk to you soon. And by the way, just so everybody knows, I'm sure we'll hear it soon, we're just sending troops to Jordan. So who knows
Great.
What we're doing there, but that's what we're doing.
And if you want more information about this, Carl, quickly say your website.
market-ticker.org.